Hi, everybody. Welcome to the latest webcast in Caring.com's Digital Marketing Academy. Our session today is focused on helping your agency succeed in attracting and converting prospective clients, or the secret sauce of home care agency sales success. I'm Denise Grob, a marketing director here at Caring.com, and I'm joined by my esteemed colleague, Peter Droubay, who I'll introduce in more depth in just a moment. Before we dive into the presentation, though, I want to cover a few housekeeping items. This is a one-way webcast where only the presenters speak. However, you can ask questions, we hope you will, in the upper right of your screen at any time during the session. We're going to have a Q&A at the end, and we're going to answer those questions. If we don't get to your question during the session, we will follow up with you afterwards. And the number one question we usually get is, will this session be recorded? And the answer is yes. We will make both the slides and recording available to you afterwards. Now, this session is free of charge, but the cost of admission is listening to a brief commercial about Caring.com, the sponsor of today's webinar. Caring.com has about 3 million visitors each month to our online senior care resources. These visitors are families and older adults who are turning to us for caregiving information, referral, and support. They also come to us for reviews about senior care providers. In fact, we are the largest senior care review site with more than 175,000 consumer reviews posted today, and we add thousands every month. We also have thousands of original articles across all caregiving and elder care topics, and we host dozens of online support groups for family caregivers. Lastly, we are partnered with thousands of senior care businesses nationwide, including some of you on the session today. Our featured presenter today is someone that we are so thrilled to have on the Caring.com team, Peter Droubay. Some of you may even be familiar with him, given his extensive experience in the home care industry, including helping to build both the Seniors Choice and Hallmark Home Care, two organizations through which he trained hundreds of home care franchises nationwide. Peter is, in fact, a renowned trainer in sales and marketing with a who's who of corporate America in his client roster and a proven track record in multiple industries, including senior care. And he also owned and operated SalesTrainer.com for 25 years. He's truly a top-notch trainer, has a wealth of practical knowledge specifically in the home care space, and besides being a phenomenal professional, he's also, as you will find out listening to him and probably working with him, he's an all-around great guy with some really wonderful real-life stories that'll leave you with both a smile and nuggets of valuable truth. As usual, we have a lot to cover today. We're going to start with the keys to effective lead generation in today's marketplace for home care. Then Peter is going to take you through how to develop sales systems to help you convert those leads. And he's going to talk about the marriage of new school to old school, online to offline, and some of the biggest mistakes that home care agencies are making today and how you can avoid them. And then we're going to summarize and open up to Q&A. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and turn over the controls to Peter. Let me just do that now. Okay. All right, Peter, you can take it away.
All right, Denise, thank you very, very much. It's my pleasure. Again, I have been around the industry for a while. Some of you on the line I may know very well. And if so, it's good to talk to you again. Again, today we're going to talk about quite a few things. We'll have to put on our track shoes and run together a little bit. Some of what I talk to you about won't be anything new for you. I wish that I had some brand new piece of information that would completely revolutionize the industry. But as we all know, it's the same old basics practiced well over and over again that make a difference. So today we're going to talk about some of those basics, hopefully a new twist on things for some of you. But the big question for you throughout the day is not necessarily, do I know this? Because much of what I'm going to talk about, you probably have heard before, or you at least know intuitively, you know it from some level of experience that you've had in the senior care industry. So it's not, do I know it, but am I applying it? Am I doing it? So worst case scenario, it'll simply be a great reminder. Best case scenario, there will be some new ideas for some people on the call. And it'll be my pleasure to walk you through some of the experience that I've had with senior care over the years, which is quite extensive. So let's go ahead and get started here. First of all, advance there. There we go. So let's talk first of all about some things that are working against us in the industry. And they're not just working against home care agencies, but small business throughout America are faced with three paradigms, three belief systems that unfortunately infect. They're almost like, you know, they're almost like diseases, like, you know, viruses that get out there. And you will recognize them as I talk about them. And as we talk more throughout this session, I'll come back to these because you'll see how they influence our thinking in a negative way, in a way that detracts from our results. The first issue is what I call the field of dreams lie. Now, I don't mean to put down the movie, love the movie, great movie, highly recommend it. If your kids haven't seen them, make them watch it, right? If you haven't seen it in a while, watch the movie, phenomenal movie. But the tagline of the movie has been used out of context far too often, especially by small business owners. You know, you remember the tagline of the business, of the movie rather, it's if you build it, they will come. And unfortunately, I've heard a lot of small business owners over the years, over the last 20 years, I've heard a lot of them talking about, well, if I build it, they'll come. Well, that's not quite true in business. They, meaning hopefully customers, consumers, people that are gonna work with us, they only come if you invite them into a proven process that sells them on what you do. But unfortunately, I hear far too many people imagining that if I simply get my doors open, if I get the business up and running, if I let people know that I'm open, that suddenly the world will beat a path to my doorstep and I will suddenly have a lot of business. That gets combined with the next major problem that we have, which is what I call the retail model. Recently, the retail model, you know, corporate giants like Walmart and many other retailers, it's an attraction for a lot of small business owners to think that I can be just like them in the sense that I can present customers with a large amount of offerings at a low price. In other words, I commoditize everything. I allow them to dictate the experience. In other words, I just sit back and do what they ask me to do. And I hire low-skilled, quote, customer service personnel. I turn into one of those myself where I'm just, you know, doing whatever people want me to do and I hope for the best. And unfortunately, this also is a major problem for small business in America and most home care agencies that I go out and talk to. And then finally, the worst of them right now is the internet dream, right? We've all had the internet dream. The internet dream is, you know, if we can put everything about our business and what we offer online, we have millions of people magically find our site or our postings or our social networking sites, whatever they may be. And when anyone shows interest, then we can sell them all online. Or at worst, we can pick up the phone and we can connect with them on the telephone, but we never have to actually do the work of going and meeting with them in person. Now, on the face of it, it seems silly, and most people wouldn't admit to believing any of these three, but the bottom line is where all of them leave us is, you know, the internet dream leaves us wondering why our dream of living on Easy Street, making money online while you sleep, is not coming true, right? The field of dreams lie, the retail model, and the internet dream are all fiction, and they need to be exposed as such for the small business owner, and that includes home care agencies throughout the country. Yet, you know, when we buy into any of these, it's a problem. So what's the alternative? Well, we're going to talk about that. Let's talk about five keys to marketing and sales success. And the big question again is, are you employing each of these? Not do I know these things? You probably know most of what I'm going to talk about, but are you employing them? So first of all, here are the five, and then I'll go through each one of them, give you some ideas and some tips on each one. Again, we could spend, days on each one of these and not exhaust the subject. So we are going to have to put on our track shoes here a bit and go through quite a bit of information quickly. But step number one, and they're not even steps. I shouldn't say steps because they don't have to be successive. But key number one is you must identify your target. As opposed to customer service and the retail model where you're just taking in whoever comes, the bottom line is if you're going to succeed in small business and the world of home care, you must identify a target. Next is you've got to build your identity. You've got to become what's called top of mind. And we'll talk more about that in a moment. You've got to create multiple marketing methods. Unfortunately, most small business in America relies on one or two pillars to support their business, one or two marketing methods, and we'll talk more about that in a moment. You've got to create a sales system to convert. This is one of the biggest mistakes going on today, is most people do not have a an accurate, quantifiable, you know, decided upon sales system that is actually successful in converting leads into consumers, into clients. And then finally, we got to measure, manage, and celebrate our success as we do. So again, let's start with step number one. Let's identify or talk about identifying a specific clientele. Do you know who your ideal client is? That's the big question. Do you know who you're after? Or are you simply, again, you know, the internet dream, the retail model, the field of dreams lie, you're just sitting back hoping for the best, hoping that you get a certain person. And the truth is, we need to make sure that we know who we're after. So the first key is you don't want to try and be everything for everybody. That's, again, the retail model. That's the Walmarts of the world. They want to be everything for everybody. We don't want to be, when you try to be everything for everybody, nobody remembers you unless you're big enough to have some uniqueness like a Walmart or, you know, one of the big retailers. So you need to ask yourself, first and foremost, who will I serve better than anyone else? What is their profile? In what ways are they not being served? What are their biggest pains, worries, concerns, and problems? And once I've identified them, what else do they do? Where and how can I reach them and let them know about me? And who already has their trust? Now, again, we know the general focus of the industry. If you're not focused in this area, then you've missed the boat somewhere. But we know the general idea of who we're after is Mary. Mary is the adult daughter or daughter-in-law, typically, once in a while a son, but most of the time it's a daughter making these decisions. They are often still working, right? They work 40 hours a week somewhere and they take care of mom or dad. They're prompted by a medical situation. In other words, what really got them into action looking, what got them over the top was something has happened. Mom fell, right? She's got some bumps, bruises, or even broken bones that she's handling. Or there's a medical situation that has grown worse. We've now advanced in the stages of Alzheimer's. Something happened, you know, along the memory care spectrum. This person is also part of what's known as the sandwich generation. You're all familiar with that term. Means that she often has kids at home. Sometimes those kids are still young. Many times they are young adults who have rebounded back home or never left, right? The whole failure to launch generation. That's a whole nother webinar as well, I think, right? Mary is often part of that sandwich generation where she has kids, she's trying to take care of parents, she's trying to handle a 40-hour a week job. And she, because of that, she's very busy. She doesn't know all of the local options. She hasn't spent a lot of time. You know, no sane, healthy, well-adjusted person spends a lot of their time thinking about their own mortality or about the end of life. We just don't. That's just not part of who we are. So I don't go around, and I'm in the industry, so I have, but most people don't go around looking at senior care options. So they don't know the local options, and then they're faced with situations where they have to know. They do listen to the advice of trusted professionals. And the other big thing that has changed in the last couple decades is that they do, even if they get the advice of trusted professionals, they do go online ahead of time in order to make sure that they do their research. They want to know. They read reviews. Reviews have become huge, and they will fill out and submit online inquiries. So this is the general scope, but many times it pays to even go deeper, to even focus deeper. In a crowded marketplace, which the industry has become, there are many home care agencies out there. Most of you are faced with not half a dozen. Most of you are faced with 30, 40, 50 different alternatives in your market. In other words, competition in your market. In a crowded marketplace, it also helps to specialize. Specialists make more than generalists, and it's a great way to carve out a niche in the beginning. So one of the things that I've taught people for a long time when they start in the industry is, you know what, start with a specialty. It could be a specialty of a medical condition. You can always broaden out later, but you can start by focusing and specializing on Alzheimer's or specializing on macular degeneration and partially sighted issues, right? Or you could focus on geography. I just focus on this one town or this one neighborhood or this one corner of town, everything south of market or east of town or west of town, right? I'm the specialist in this area. I know everyone in this area. I'm not trying to be everything for everybody, just this one area. You fill up that area first. Hobby, interest, possession. I know somebody who focused on one hobby, the symphony, went to the symphony, found out all of their donors and patrons who were not coming out lately because unable to. Their age had advanced and they didn't have the resources to get out to the symphony as much. And they put together a package where they would do an assessment. They would help people get ready, get out to the symphony one more time. Even if it was just 1 4-hour shift to get them out there, it was at least an entry into that potential assignment. It was just one example of many, many, but you can do anything that's hobby, interest, possession related, or you can focus on gender, ethnicity, or family traits. Nothing wrong with saying that you focus on a caregivers that speak a certain language because they handle a certain clientele, right? There's all sorts of ways of doing this, but in a crowded marketplace, you probably need to specialize. So the first key is specialization. And once you do that, you've got to create, you've got to identify those people, as opposed to sitting back and being the retail model where people come to you. You've got to identify them. And that means you identify not only the seniors and their families, but the potential referral partners for those niches. And to do that, you've got to identify them, put them into some sort of electronic form that you can interact with them consistently. Again, everybody knows this. And at the same time, how well are you doing it? How up to date is your CRM? How useful is it? How often are you in it? How effective are you at using your CRM to consistently contact and work with a specific clientele? And these days we have social networks that do a lot of that for us. But again, how good is it for you? Are you up on all the major social networks? Have you built your clientele within that, or the people that you're influencing, all of your referral partners? How well are you doing at identifying and keeping track of your ideal clients? That leads us to the second step that you've got to do, and that is that you've got to become top of mind with your ideal clients. Are you the first business thought of within a particular niche? Again, top of mind is an old advertising term, means the first person thought of or the first business thought of within a certain segment of the market, and you want to be that business. What if every potential referral source in your area, every discharge planner, every doctor, every pharmacist, you name it, the list goes on, if they all thought of your agency first whenever somebody asked about senior care, whenever somebody was faced with that potential issue of I need help at home, what if you were the first person thought of? And that can be accomplished, but it takes some effort. So again, some of the things that we teach here, number one is you've got to identify what makes you unique and different. One of my pet peeves is I will go out to senior care agencies and talk to them, and I'll ask them, well, what do you do? And they say, well, I'm in senior care. Well, you know, everybody says they're in senior care. What's different about you? How do you do it? Oh, we care for people at home. Well, that's the definition of home care agencies, right? What makes you different than your, why would I hire your agency as opposed to all the rest? Right? And don't tell me it's because you're cheaper, right? You've just denigrated your whole agency at that point. So it's not because you're cheaper, it's because you're better at something. What is the something, right? Your unique selling proposition must clearly state who you serve that is different from everybody else, how you serve them that is different from everybody else, and what makes you unique. Why you as opposed to everybody else? And then you've got to shout it from the rooftops. It has to be part of every single conversation, every single communication that you send out of your business. Now, there are three accelerators to this. If you want to be known, if you want to be the top of mind agency in your area, you've got to pay attention to three things after having created your USP. If you don't know what makes you unique, if everybody in your practice can't verbalize that immediately, if I walk in and you've got a receptionist working for you and he or she can't verbalize what makes your agency unique, then these three accelerators won't help you. Right? You've got to make sure that everybody in your business knows exactly what that's about. But once you do, three accelerators. The first is called social proof, an old social psychologist term that means essentially that we tend to take our cues for proving our ideas from the people around us. When we're uncertain of what to do next, we look to people around us that seem to be certain. And so this is the principle behind any sort of endorsement or testimonial or referrals. This is why referrals are so important, right? So how do we do that? Well, again, it's simply a focus, and there's some exact mechanics we won't go through here today. But number one is you've got to start looking for endorsements. Who will endorse your agency? Who will put their name up as an endorsement? And that includes referring to you. Online reviews have become huge. And yes, we're tooting our own horn because caring.com is heavily involved in online reviews, but frankly, your people are going there. It used to be that if the discharge planner said, go to XYZ agency, everybody went to XYZ agency no matter what. But I'll tell you what happens now. The discharge planner says, go to XYZ agency. The son or daughter, the baby boom age son or daughter, pulls out their phone and looks up your agency and immediately looks at the reviews. Just like we look at reviews for where to buy our tires, where to buy, you know, where to go to dinner, right? We go on and we look for who has the best reviews, what hotel to stay at. We're constantly looking at how it's rated, what kind of reviews. And if you don't have any reviews, it's one of the challenges, right? The baby boom age will pull out that phone and they'll look right there. Testimonials are huge. That can be part of the reviews or separate from that. Seeking those testimonials is a major, major part. So again, I'm not going to belabor the point here. Reviews help boost sales. We've seen it in our work with agencies. When people go out to look online, 8 in 10 consumers will trust an online review as much as a personal recommendation. And we've been able to see that through a wide variety of studies and different ways of doing that. We also know from direct case studies that home care agencies that with listings that have at least 15 or more reviews are 1.5 times more, they get 1.5 times more leads than the listings with only 1 or 2 reviews. In other words, people are clicking there first. They're going there first, just like you would with just about any other element of our marketplace. The second accelerator that you've got to get involved with, number one is social proof. If you're not building your social proof, then you got to start there. But the second thing is, this is the education age. Now, we used to, a lot of people were talking about how, you know, a couple decades ago, we went into what they were calling the entertainment age, where it was all about entertainment. And I would argue that we've transitioned from that into what I would call the edutainment. In other words, we still have a flair of entertainment involved, but now we don't just want fluff, and we don't want marketing, and we don't want advertising thrown at us. What we want is we want to know. The internet and the availability of information has given us that desire to know, because we can. We can go and find things out that we never could before. So I want to get educated. I don't just want to be told where to go. I want to be an educated consumer, is the desire that most people have. And so education becomes a huge part of this. And you can set yourself apart by focusing on teaching. Teaching what you do. A lot of people say, well, I don't want to teach them what I do because then they can do it themselves. And that's just the opposite. When you teach, it draws people to you as the expert. We see people as being experts and expertise in our society based on how much they teach about what they do. So the easiest way to start this is to start by teaching. Articles published on your blog, if you don't have a blog, well, you got to start, right? Social networks, if you don't have them set up to be able to take your blog posts or your articles, then you need to change that. Or you can even still, there's still a market out there to submit to periodicals, the local newspapers. You know, the little small town newspaper still exists, and guess who reads it, right? Our seniors still read those newspapers. And while they're not always the decision makers, they are definite influencers, and they will speak up about who they've read about. So submitting articles to the local periodicals makes a huge difference. So one of the things that I've taught people to do for a long time is once a week, you've got to put together an article, and it's simpler than you think. It's simply about teaching people some aspect of senior care. There's hundreds of articles that could be had. And these days, you don't even have to write it yourself. There's a ton of people that will write for you. There's a ton of websites where you can get people writing for you. There's a ton of content out there that you can license. It's really easy to get that going, but it becomes a consistent thing, a consistent drumbeat. Same thing with videos and audios. We all know that online these days, videos are king, right? The more videos we can get, the more they'll go viral. I think I was joking with Denise before we even started about, you know, cat videos. We had to throw up a cat video and all of you would really love it, because apparently cat videos are the rage. And Denise agreed. She loves cat videos. So there you go. That's who's watching them. So the videos and audios published on your site make a huge difference. And you know what? That can even get you into TV and radio. Have had tons and tons of folks that I've coached and taught that have gone out to TV and radio and wound up with a lot of PR and a lot of press for free on TV and radio. And then speaking and teaching, getting out and teaching, one of the best ways to create your identity is to get out in the community and teach about senior care. And there are hundreds, if not thousands, of places that you could go and speak every single week if you wanted to. You could set yourself up to where you're speaking every single day. And if you doubt that, you got to come talk to me, because I've done it, right? We've seen people do it, and I've coached people to do it. It's really easy to go out and talk to people, and it builds your identity. So education is key. You've got to be able to get out and educate. And by the way, I mentioned that all of this needs to go on your website and your email and things like that. Well, guess what? Seniors that we're talking about, they're online as well, right? We all know this, that seniors, you know, 65 plus, annual income 75K and above, 87% of them are online. Most of them daily. 81% own smartphones, 65% use tablets, 57% are on social networks. Facebook, you know, is huge. And, you know, despite their recent challenges and their recent PR nightmares, the truth is they are still used by billions of people. And that includes a lot of seniors, right? So the question is, what are they finding out about you? Or do you have that education out there? Are those, are you consistently getting out that social proof? Are they seeing you as being a top of mind source for senior care? The last thing is repetition. There has to be some repetition in building your brand. You can't do this once and then you're done. It has to be scheduled every single week. Do you have a mail piece going out every single week? Do you have an email piece? Again, not an advertisement, but education. Do you have education going out by email every single week? Are you posting every single week with good, solid education that would cause both your referral network, you know, the professionals out there that are helping to refer business to your agency, are they seeing something positive that they can learn from every single week on your posts, in your emails, in their mailbox? And if not, they will unsubscribe pretty quick. But if you are educating and you're doing it repeatedly, they may not read every article you post or watch every video that you produce, but they will see your name over and over again. And they will keep themselves there because they know it's good, solid education. And then frankly, you've got to, part of the repetition is you've got to interact. It can't be a post and then leave it, right? You've got to interact these days with all of the responses. That means responding to any comments that come in off of things that you send out. It also means responding to any negative reviews or even positive reviews. So again, three accelerators, you've got to build your brand in the marketplace. So here's the bottom line. Do you have scheduled times to do the following every single week? Are you soliciting endorsements, reviews, and testimonials every single week? If you're not, somebody in your business has to start doing that, or you're losing ground. Are you writing an article or having one written for you, an educational piece? Could be an article, could be something that gets turned into a video or an audio, but are you doing one per week or having it done? And then are you posting it? Your blog, your social networks, right? Periodicals in the area. Are you emailing to subscribers every single week? Are you mailing to subscribers? You could probably back that off to once a month. But again, even though that's, you know, we've all said direct mail's dead. Well, the truth is it's dead for direct response. Well, marketing to get actual leads off of direct mail is not very effective these days, although some people still get good leads that way. But it is phenomenal for creating and building your reputation and building your identity. So again, there's two types of marketing. There's brand building marketing, identity building, and then there's direct response, meaning producing leads. And mail is not as effective for direct response anymore, but it is phenomenal for building your brand. Are you scheduling and delivering at least one class or speaking engagement per week? Again, why talk to one person at a time when you can talk to 100 at a time? And there are tons of groups meeting, in both professional groups as well as just social and networking groups, every single week in your community, and they are desperate for people to come talk to them, right? So get out and talk to these people and put together a great program, educational program, on any number of senior care issues that are out there. And then finally, do you have somebody monitoring posts and reviews and responding to all of them? Engaging in that communication is a major part of building your brand. All right, let's talk about developing multiple methods of marketing. How many pillars are supporting your business? And the metaphor that I'm talking about is a metaphor that you know, is a little different from, you know, if you went to business school, you got taught about channels, right? Channel marketing. And channels are basically an irrigation metaphor about moving water out in the fields through different channels. Well, I'm not a farmer, never been a farmer. Worked on a farm as a teenager, but that's about it. And so it doesn't quite ring true for me, that metaphor, but the building does. It's simply a metaphor, same concept. And that is that your building has to be supported by numerous pillars. The pillars are each marketing methods. Unfortunately, small business in America, this includes home care agencies, are often stuck trying to support their entire business on one or two pillars, right? If they're following the retail model, the pillar is walk-in traffic, right? Which makes no sense in our business necessarily, but I've met people that, you know, open a storefront and think that that's going to do it for them. The internet dream is there for a lot of people, right? That people are suddenly going to beat a path to my website or to my social networking site, and I'm going to get all of this traffic suddenly. And while that might be a pillar, if you rely on it as the only pillar, you've got a major problem. Same thing with any pillar. So what you want is you want anywhere from half a dozen to a dozen consistent marketing methods proven to produce leads every single month. If you don't have at least 8 to 12 good ways to produce leads, things that are producing leads every single month, then you're in trouble. And the trouble is that you never know when one of these is going to stop working, right? On a given month, if you've got a dozen pillars, a dozen different marketing methods set up, each month there's one or two that may not produce a single lead for you. And so thank goodness you got the other 10. And with each of those 10, you should have a system worked out to where you know exactly what you need to do, how much you need to spend, how much you need to do, what you need to send out, how you need to send it out, all of those things in order to produce a predictable flow of leads. And so look for those things. Now, I know that a lot of people, you know, take a look at professional referrals and they say, oh, that's it. I'm only going to do that. And you know what? That may work for a while. And that is the best source. At the same time, you need other sources because, frankly, you never know when allegiances change. You never know when professionals retire. You never know when people stop sending you those referrals and those leads. You never know when your competitor gets in and makes friends with the people that were sending you those referrals. It's tough to bank on professional referrals as being your only source, so you've got to add to that. Add to all of those professional referrals by doing quite a bit more. And obviously, these days, a lot more is moving online. In fact, you know, that's where, you know, we are seeing, and you've seen it as well, that traditional marketing, what we used to call traditional, is declining. Yellow pages are all but dead. You know, direct mail, I've already mentioned, is good for brand building, but not much else. Newspaper advertising has declined, on and on and on. The traditional ways of marketing has become less. Online or digital is rising, and frankly, because of the way that it goes, lead generation online has become huge. So caring.com leads have become bigger and bigger and bigger for home care. We obviously highly recommend them because they're us, right? We're tooting our own horn again, but we have lots and lots of people that have built huge businesses by working the leads that they buy from us. And they are some of the cheapest leads that you can buy. But even then, they shouldn't be your only pillar. You should have a half a dozen to a dozen different pillars that are consistently working for you every single month. Now, you've got to build sales systems to back that up. Otherwise, getting all the leads isn't going to make a difference. And so this is an area where I'll spend a little bit more time because, frankly, I see some of the biggest mistakes happening here. Do you have an effective way to convert leads into clients? And it starts with systemization. In other words, have you identified the steps and the processes for each one of the systems? In other words, does every one of those pillars have its own system that you know predictably can produce leads every single month? And if it doesn't, then you've got to back up and create that process. Because the big question is, does everyone in your business know exactly how to generate leads? Does everybody in your business know where the leads come from and how they get generated? In other words, what are the steps that we go through? Do they know exactly what to do with each lead that comes in? And that's what we want to talk about here. Do you have a sales process, a sales system? Because one of the biggest mistakes I see is leads come in and there is no consistent process for working that lead. So now, what is a system? Let's stop there for a moment. A system has certain characteristics. First of all, it's a repetitive way of doing things. We all know that. But whether you have a good system or not really comes down to several keys. Number one is, do you have defined positions? In other words, duties, tasks, things that people do, defined positions where people know what their job is and they know how they go about doing that. Is there training for that? If you had to replace those people, do you know how to train them? Do you know how to teach them? Part of that is, do they have specific scripts that they use? They say the same thing over and over again. Are there forms and different, process elements such as a form, whether it be online or offline? In other words, in your CRM, are there forms built in so that when we follow up with this lead, we know exactly what the script is, we know what form to fill out? Do we have measurement tools? Are we measuring what's happening? And then is there coaching, management, and accountability with each one of these processes? So let's take a look, for instance, at some great systems and some bad ones, and find out what they're doing to illustrate what I'm talking about. First of all, let me tell you again, another big pet peeve. I already told you one pet peeve. When I go out to a lot of home care agencies throughout the country, is I ask them, what do you do that's unique and different? And I already told you the response that I get from too many of them. Here's another huge pet peeve, is that a lot of home care agencies do not have an identifiable system for following up with leads, wherever those leads come from. And so what that does is, unfortunately, many home care agencies, because they don't have a sales system, there's no defined process. So they wind up grabbing every lead and calling it as quickly as possible, which is not a bad thing. But then their whole thing is compressed into one step. In other words, the step is call and close them, right? They go back maybe to some of the old time sales jargon about, the ABCs of closing, always be closing. And theoretically, I agree with that. You got to have an attitude of constantly looking for business. But if your process has one step, it's not a process and it's doomed to failure. If you're trying to close everything over the telephone, you've got a problem. And we see that, unfortunately. We have some people that buy our leads, and the one and only thing they do is they call it, they overqualify it right away because they're expecting a perfect lead every time. I want somebody to be a 24/7 client right now. I want them to say that they're willing to bill all the hours and that they have, $50,000 a month disposable income that they can spend on this. And if it's not that way, then I'm not so excited about the lead. Well, the truth is, it could be that way, but there's a process to getting it there. Step number one should not be to call and close them on the first call. If you do manage to close a few, I promise you your billable hours are lower than what they should be, because most people don't do that. So here's the key idea, and Denise mentioned this in the intro. One of the major key ideas that you want to get good at in this market, in this economy, is you can become wealthy if you integrate today's technology with personal emotional sales psychology. So consider the following. First thing is that major decisions involve some degree of emotion if we're going to make the decision effectively. Emotion is best influenced in person, face to face, belly to belly. Emotion is best accessed through questions, through a discovery, an assessment, a questioning process. That's how we get at emotions. Therefore, the internet and the telephone should only be used for setting appointments to conduct a thorough assessment. If you don't have a step-by-step process that includes that, then you're missing the boat. When you try to do it all over the internet or the telephone, you lose. So the key is to marry the online with the offline, right? The new school with the old school. And if you can do that, you'll be very successful. So for instance, here's an example of a successful system. All leads, every lead, no matter where they come from, go into your CRM and they get noted as to where they come from so that you can track that, right? But then they are immediately called and called until we reach them. And we're measuring that. What percentage of the leads are we actually contacting and communicating with? When we communicate, though, it needs to be a very specific script, hopefully by the same person or people each time, so that they can really get good at it. They know how to do it. And they have a script to follow, and it's very minimal qualification. We're going to assume that our lead generation efforts are doing some of the qualifying for you. And if that's a mystery to you, then we can talk offline later. But the bottom line is that you want to make sure that you've got a semi-qualified lead, so there's minimal qualification. And we are not trying to sell them on a care plan right now. Instead, we're booking assessments. No prices or care hours are quoted until after the assessment. You can certainly quote ranges, that kind of thing. But the bottom line is that we want to get to the assessment. Appointments are booked for care coordinators or salespeople to go out and do that. And the measurement for the appointment setter is based on conversion to appointments. They're literally measured on that. If you don't have somebody who's accountable to that quota, or that percentage every single month, then you've got to back up and take a look at that. assessments are conducted and they're not a presentation. That's the other thing. I had a neighbor years ago that called me over, said, I've got this person from a home care agency over here trying to sell me. And I was dismayed that he hadn't called me first, but I went over and God bless her. She was a wonderful person, but she had come in to do a presentation on why they should hire that agency. Was not doing any sort of intake assessment, client assessment of any sort. Again, you've got to, this basic sales psychology, you've got to tap into the emotion first, and you do that through an assessment. So do you have one that's well formatted, that's based on good salesmanship, that's meant to elicit emotion and care needs? And it's only after that that you structure a proposal and develop and deliver that proposal on site. So again, this is an example of a good system. Let me see if I can get this slide to advance there. Here we go. And we see this through our most successful people time and time again, right? People that, as we measure people that consistently close the leads that they get from us at 10% or higher, and we have people that close quite a bit more than that, we find that they consistently have these attributes. They have one person who handles the phones, and that person is measured based on very specific things. They're measured based on how many of the leads they get a hold of, and they're measured on how many assessments they convert those leads to. And then the agency does an assessment and is only quoting prices after that and moving people forward. So ask yourself, do you have one person whose job it is to talk to all incoming leads? Does that person have a script? Are there corresponding forms to fill out, whether online or off? Does that person understand that the telephone is only for setting appointments? I'm not trying to close this deal over the phone. Are you tracking the calls made and the conversion rate to appointments set? Do you have actual numbers and measurements that you can sit down with that person on a monthly coaching and accountability session and say, okay, the percentage is this. Why is it this? Why is it that low? Or why is it, you know, not higher, et cetera? How do we get it to be higher? And then when we do the assessment or the intake assessment, first of all, do you have one? Do you have a scripted set way of doing an assessment? And is it done the exact same way each time? How do you teach it? How do you measure the results? If you're doing this well, you should be getting a very high ratio of people that go from assessment to client. But again, it has to be a set form, a set way of doing it that you know is working. And that leads us to the measuring, managing, and celebrating, which is the final piece here, and I won't belabor it, but you've got to trust your systems, right? The old Reagan mantra about trust but verify. Well, in this case, trust your systems but verify they're producing. So there need to be actual numbers-based accountability in your business. The numbers or leads from each marketing method. Do you know exactly what's being produced every month from each marketing method? Do you know what the conversion rate to appointments are out of that? Again, if you don't have a sales system that involves an appointment, then that's a problem. But if you have those, do you know what the rates are? Do you know whether this month was better than last month or not in terms of your ratio of appointments set? Do you have a conversion rate from appointment to client? In other words, do we know how many of those assessments are being converted? And then finally, all of that is informed or leads into what we call average client value and client acquisition costs, which is really where the rubber meets the road when it comes to all marketing, right? Average gross profit margin per month times the number of months that an average client uses your services is what's called your average client value. Now, you should figure it out for your business. Again, you hopefully are targeting a specific niche in a specific market with specific people, and therefore your client value might be different from industry averages. But the latest averages tend to hold it somewhere between $10,000 and $12,000 per person in terms of average client value per client. Again, this is an average client. That doesn't mean every client is going to be worth that much, but overall average for the industry winds up being about that much. Hopefully yours is higher, maybe it's a little lower, but either way, it doesn't matter. You just simply need to know what it is, because that informs how much you can actually spend. Right? Client acquisition cost is the amount you're spending on marketing divided by the number of new clients. In other words, what did I spend to get each new client? And you've got to determine what percentage of client value you're willing to spend. Again, part of this goes into being able to measure all these things in your business. And if you can't do that, then we've got to back up and make sure that you've got systems that are being measured. But once they are, you've got to determine what percentage. Theoretically, if it's $11,000 per new client, theoretically, you could spend $10,999 and still be profitable. Now, we don't want to be that small of our profit margin. So obviously there's going to be a threshold. Is it 20%? Is it 30% of client value that you're going to spend on acquisition? Again, this is something that I see with a lot of, especially newer home care agencies or ones that are smaller or floundering in different ways, is they don't have a real hold on what client value is. Therefore, they're overly sensitive to spending money. They don't spend it in the right ways. They tend to throw money at things that don't really produce, the kind of results. They don't have the systems to produce those results to begin with. And then they're overly worried about spending any money because they don't know how much their client value is and they're not tracking what the lead acquisition cost is, okay? So again, this is all about turning a dollar into five or a dollar into 10. That's our goal, is to take our money and magnify it through this business, serving the people that we serve, but also earning money for ourselves. And that is really where we're going. So here's the key takeaways. I know we've run through a lot quickly, and if we had 10 hours here, I'd go into deep depth on each one of these, but we don't, and it's just to remind you of some things, get you thinking in some different ways. First thing is, don't buy into the no work myths. Again, these myths all have at their core this idea that somehow we can get away with not having to work as much, right? The field of dreams lie is that, if we build it, they'll show up. If we simply open our doors, people will show up. All we got to do is hang that shingle out there that says we're in the business and suddenly we'll have business. And that is a lie. We all know it, right? The retail model is that you sit back and let people do what they want to do. There's no outbound sales effort in the retail model. And that's not this industry. That's not this business if you're going to do it right. The internet dream, again, is just that. It's the dream of making all your money on the internet, not having to work. Getting to lay on a beach somewhere is the classic idea, right? I get to lay on a beach and have everything happening for me. And we all know that that's not reality. So I also want you to focus on identifying a clientele and building a top of mind, unique selling proposition. If I walk into your business, does everybody in your business know how to, even right down to the caregivers, do your caregivers know how to describe what makes you unique or different? Why does your agency stand out from the rest? Do your caregivers know that? Can they tell me that? And once you have that, then you've got to magnify that these days. Social proof, get those online reviews and testimonials going. Education, start educating, teaching people. Repetition, you've got to do it over and over again. And pretty soon you become known as the place to go to. Online to offline, a major key to success these days. We can't do everything over the telephone or online, but those are very important and critical ways of generating leads. If you're not buying leads from caring.com, you're foolish. You've got to. It's a great way, and there's thousands of people that are coming online these days in order to do that. And frankly, if you're not doing a lot of things online yourself, you're also foolish. But you can't just take those leads and then keep everything online or in arm's length or over the phone. Again, that goes back into that sort of internet dream where I think I can do this without having to work. It's still, we've got to get out and we've got to have a real sales process. So that's the last one, is build systems that have you setting appointments for client assessments. Get in front of clients. It makes all the difference in the world. So with that, Denise, I think we're, I've run through everything I can as quickly as I can.
Yes, thank you so much, Peter. And we do have time for questions. If folks on the line want to ask a question, there's a module in the upper right. We did get a question when you were talking about assessments. The agency is asking if you recommend that they charge for assessments. There is a concern that they'll lose a lot of time going out and doing all those assessments.
Yeah. So first of all, charging for assessments is not what I recommend. I recommend that it be a part of your business. Now, I've seen it done a couple different ways where a value is put on that assessment, but you're not necessarily charging for it. And yes, there is a lot of, a lot of people say, oh, what about all the time? Trust me, the billable hours that you get that are increased by doing the assessment will more than pay for the time. One of the things that I've seen over and over again, if you are not doing assessments, your billable hours per client are way down from agencies that consistently go out and do quality assessments. And the reason is because once you're on site, you find all sorts of things that they actually need and want, and by asking questions appropriately, doing the discovery the right way, you're opening up all of those emotional wounds. You should get the entire family, all of the influencers there. And that's where you get even the siblings that don't think mom needs any help. they come to realize mom does need help, and suddenly they're willing to pitch in. Suddenly there's more money available. Every time, I mean, trust me on this, you do assessments, you will get more billable hours sooner per client, and it will more than pay for the increased time. And frankly, you're not going to close as many over the phone as you thought, you know, you might. So do the assessments, and no, you don't have to charge for them. You can if you want. I've seen some agencies do it. Most of the time, they will attach a value to it, but not actually charge.
Great. Thank you, Peter. We got another question that we commonly get in our webinars, and that is, what CRM should they use? Those of you partnered with caring.com, we have my portal for home care agencies that helps you track all the leads that you receive from us. But Peter, do you have any other recommendations for CRM?
Oh, you know what? So this is a constant battle, and I don't want to side with one provider over another. Certainly there's the standard sales CRMs like Salesforce and ones like that that you can do. There's also a lot of the scheduling software. Softwares have now built in elements of a CRM. Some are better than others, but ClearCare and ERSP and, you know, HomeTrack and some of the others, you know, they all have CRM elements to them. And you can investigate that. They're not as robust as a pure CRM. So I'm not gonna give you a definitive, because again, especially with technology, if I tell you a definitive right now, then tomorrow somebody else will invent one that's even better, right? But go out and do your research. Find a great CRM. Look first in your whatever scheduling software you're using. Look first within that scheduling software to see if the CRM element of it is robust enough. Not all of them are for what you really need to do, but some are.
Great. Thank you, Peter. We got a question about one of the recommendations or success stories shared was having a person dedicated to sales. And this agency owner is asking about, first of all, how do they find a person focused on that particular task? And then how do they find the budget to pay for that person? How much time should they give them to prove their wealth? Do you have any guidance for folks on that?
Yeah, that's a webinar in and of itself.
Yeah.
And I have spoken at numerous conferences on how to hire people. So let me see if I can distill a little bit down into a minute here. So a couple things. Number one is that when to hire all has to do with, you know, let's face it, when you first start, this is, you know, you've got to wear all the hats. So you've got to do it. And the first advice that I would have you is that you retain the sales function. If you're the owner, that you retain that function as long as possible and replace yourself in other areas, because frankly, nobody sells your business like you do. So it starts with getting other people to do the scheduling and getting other people to do the hiring and and the training of caregivers and things like that, and the care coordination. Those can often be easier things to hire. As far as hiring salespeople, number one is that you've got to have the revenues to do it. Every staff member, you've got to have at least a $250,000, you know, in revenues to justify every full-time staff beyond caregivers, and probably a little bit more than that at times. And then as far as salespeople, they need to be on an incentive pay, certainly a base plus. There's lots of ways of doing that effectively, but you also need to hire people with a history of outside sales, of account-based sales management. In other words, they're going out and producing, developing accounts and producing those accounts. And you can even divorce that from or split that up from a salesperson versus the person setting your appointments is a different person. If you've got a lead flow coming in that's being produced by you, I would start by getting somebody on the phones to set the appointments and really training him or her up to do that extremely well first, and then replace yourself in the outside role producing those leads. And certainly there are ways that you can produce leads without that. You can buy caring.com leads, and it doesn't require an outside salesperson, but it still requires that person on the phone. So without getting into, again, we could spend, you know, a couple hours on the hiring process, and I often do with people, but that's what I can give you in a minute. So.
Thank you. Those are some great tips. We also had a question about how many times should you attempt to make first contact with those fresh leads?
At least a dozen. And the reason being is that when you get that fresh lead in, first of all, there is something called speed to lead in the marketing world. The faster you get a hold of them, the better. That's especially true in today's day and age where we have a lot of it being generated over the internet or through advertising. The faster you can get a hold of them, the quicker. So you always try and place a call immediately, but those leads, there should be a call cycle that's well-defined and built into your CRM so that it's automatically setting up those call cycles for you. If we don't reach them on the first call, you definitely, over the first couple weeks, there need to be at least a dozen calls placed. What we find is that some of your best results happen between the fifth and the eighth call. Again, people are busy. They often, it rolls to voicemail. A lot of people screen their calls through voicemail. So again, have a scripted voicemail message to leave. And the biggest thing is make sure that even on that scripted voicemail message, that you're offering an assessment, not trying to call and sell them. If you're too salesman-y, but if the call is all about, I'm calling to help you and see what we can do to figure out, see what the best options for you are. The best way to do that is we set up an assessment. So give me a call back and we'll chat about that. It's much different than I'm calling to sell you on this. So between the fifth and eighth is the sweet spot, but I would make up to a dozen, and that personalized emails that go out as well. If it came in online, connecting with them on social media can also help, etc.
Great. And then speaking of scripting, that could be a webinar on itself as well, but there's a question, is there a way to find, is there a depository of winning scripts out there? Any tips for scripts?
No, at the end of the day, that's part and parcel to a franchise system, right? Franchises typically will provide you with those kinds of things. If you're a solo operator building it on your own, then you're going to have to write and produce your own and then test them and figure out what works. And, there's lots of people you can get advice from. There's lots of places that you can go to get the advice, but I don't know of any, and what you're talking about is essentially buying a ready-made system, which is the definition of a franchise, right?
Yeah. Okay, great. So maybe in the future, we'll look at doing a scripting webinar as well as hiring. One last question. The industry statistic that you shared of the client value, 11,000, they're curious if that was a revenue number or a gross profit number, and if you were referencing monthly or annual.
So that is, let's back up. The definition for client value is not time dependent. You can make it time dependent, but that is lifetime value. So that's the lifetime of your average client, which in the most recent studies tends to be between, 14 and 16 months, 18 months being about where it was before. And I think we're dropping a little bit of late. So your lifetime value, most clients, if you average them all out, that includes the people that unfortunately leave us or pass away in the first week and the people that are with us for many years. The average tends to be in that 18-month or slightly less mark. And then when we're talking about lifetime value, we're talking about the gross profit margin. So this is, your revenue minus your costs of care. So what you pay the caregivers, the fully burdened cost of your caregivers, that includes obviously all the burdens on that unemployment and any other direct costs. Those direct costs get pulled out so that we have a gross profit margin. And then it's simply that gross profit margin for the average client. So if the average client bills 20 hours a week and, your gross profit margin on average per hour is, let's say it's $6 per hour, then we're talking about obviously 6 times 20, 120 per week. And then you got your monthly and then they're there for 18 months and that becomes your deal. Again, that number fluctuates depending on who you're talking to, and each individual agency is going to have a slightly different number based on who they're targeting. If your primary target is 24/7 clients and that's all you accept, well then shoot, it's going to be a lot higher, right? If you target an audience where you've got a lot fewer hours, you're only doing respite care, a few hours per week for people, then it might be lower. If you're focused only on hospice care, it's going to be lower because they're not with you as long, right? So it varies based on who your target is, but you need to know, you know, what it is for you, because that's how you determine what the value of a client is. So people come to us all the time and they say, you know, should I, this person for this newspaper wants me to spend, you know, $500 on this ad, is it worth it? Well, again, is it worth it? That question all goes back to how many clients are you going to get out of it? What's the value of those clients? How many leads should I buy from caring.com? Well, okay, so let's do the math. If you buy 20 leads a month, right? 20 leads a month times 50 is $1,000. Is that $1,000 well spent? Well, the question is, how many of those leads are you going to convert? If you only convert 10%, then you've got two clients out of that, right? And so two clients, when we look at the lifetime value of it, you spend $1,000 to get two clients, and if the lifetime value is $20,000 plus, then you're multiplying by 10 times. And you didn't have to close 90% of them. If you can close 20%, you're that much further ahead. But that's how you make your marketing judgments on anything. That includes, you know, how do I make my marketing judgment on whether to, you know, spend money on a website or throw up, you know, money into a periodical or do, you know, buy time on a radio deal or whatever. I don't know what you're doing, but that is the ultimate question in terms of, you know, can I spend this money? Should I spend this money? And sometimes there is a test involved. You just have to, you know, do a test and see what kind of results you get. But then you always bring that back to the average client value, because that informs whether it was worth it or not. So if I bought 100 leads from caring.com and I only closed two of them, is it still worth it? Right? That's the big question. And, you know, again, you've got to do that math. But, you know, the short answer is, yeah, it actually is. But and it's more than worth it. You've more than doubled your money, or quadrupled it, actually. So the bottom line is, we want you to close more than that. You should be closing more than that if you have a good sales system. But at the end of the day, it really comes down to a math problem. It's funny. I sat with, Fred Smith, the founder of FedEx. I had the unique opportunity of having lunch with him one time. And I sat with him and, you know, asked him about a whole bunch of questions. And he said something to me twice in that conversation that I've never forgotten. He said, at the end of the day, Peter, business is about doing good math. If you can do good math, then you can do business. And that's what that all is. That's how that calculation goes. So yes, it's gross profit margin. It's not, you can calculate it for a 3-month period or a 6-month period, but the overall consideration is lifetime value, which is more than a year at this point. Hopefully that makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense. Thank you so much. And we did get my favorite question. Will this session be recorded? The answer is yes, so you can share it with others on your team. We'll be circulating that tomorrow to your inbox, or you can get in touch with us and we'll get that to you. I want to thank everyone for the questions you asked. If you think of something afterward, we're still available, so you can get those to us. Before we leave, though, I just want to let you know about our next webinar, which we talked about Mary a little bit here, but we're going to go into more depth on the research that we did. And all of the findings relevant to how they search for home care agencies, what leads them to hire certain home care agencies. So we'll be covering that. It also covers senior living as well. And that, look for an invite coming soon to your inbox. Lastly, I just want to thank you all for taking time. I want to thank our speaker. Really great information shared today. I hope you found the information helpful. Peter has graciously offered his telephone and email should you have any follow-up questions. You're seeing those now on the screen. And also, we believe in feedback. Not only do we host reviews about your home care agencies, but we welcome your feedback. You're going to be prompted at the end of this session to tell us how we did. Was it helpful to you? What did you like most? What would you suggest for next time? If you have any ideas for webinars you want us to cover, include that there. You will be prompted, like I said, when I close this webinar, as well as following up via email. Thank you very much for your time today, including you, Peter. Really appreciate you sharing your wealth of knowledge.
Sure.
Have a great day, everybody.
Take care, everyone.